Consider supporting Archaeosoup on Patreon for as little as a dollar per month. Link available in the video description. Thank you. Hello and welcome back. It has been a hot minute, has it not, since I last shared with you a Welsh tale on this YouTube channel. And there is a reason for that, and that is primarily that the source material, the two books that I was using to share these tales with you, one of the authors reached out to me and essentially was like, cease and desist. You have not got permission to perform this story. Even though it's a retelling of a story that really belongs to no one and everyone, I can understand where they were coming from, despite the fact that I was definitely sending business their way. I acted accordingly, and the search began to try and find a replacement, a version of the stories that I wanted to share, in so much as there are lots of open source versions. And incidentally, thank you so much to those people who sent links and made suggestions and pointed me to versions of the books that were out of copyright. The issue, though, was that lots of these were sort of pseudo-Shakespearean in their language. They were written by people, notably sort of in the late 19th, early 20th centuries, who were trying to elevate the tales to the level of Shakespeare, as it were, to reach some sort of parity with that kind of way of talking. And so the floweriness got in the way of the tale, of the stories, of the purity of these stories, which aren't English tales. They're not medieval English tales, they're medieval Welsh tales. And so I thought it was important to choose something that had language that was a little bit softer. And eventually, a couple of weeks ago, my search finally ended actually where my love of the Mabinogion began, namely with Tales from the Mabinogion by Gwyn Thomas and Kevin Crossley Holland, with illustrations by Margaret Jones. And this book is not only my childhood copy, it's the version that actually introduced me to these ancient tales in the first place. It was published the year I was born, 1984. Fate and destiny, I tell you. But more importantly, the publishing was by the Welsh Arts Council, and it makes no provision for limiting performance rights. The Welsh Arts Council seemingly wanted people to be able to share these tales, share a bit of Welsh culture, and to do so freely. So, ironically enough, the book that I always had with me, the book that was always upstairs in one of our bookshelves, is the book that I'm going to be sharing with you today. And I want to share with you the tale of Branwen. Branwen, the sister of Bran. And Bran himself actually is an interesting character. He's a giant, literally a giant, but also he's a giant, a giant of Welsh mythology. There's a castle not too far from where I grew up called Dinas Bran. The ruins of a castle on a crag in a valley, which has its own legends surrounding it. But that was one of his homes. Bran means crow or raven in Welsh, and actually, his name is written here is Bendigeid Bran, which is Bran the Blessed, or the Blessed Crow, the Blessed Raven. And that's important for the end of this story. I'm going to be telling this tale in two parts. And by the end of part two, we need to hold on to this notion that Bran means raven or crow. It is important. You may also have heard the name Bran in the context of the Game of Thrones stories, Bran the Broken, which I'm pretty sure is a name inspired by Bran from Welsh legends. But again, we'll come back to that, I think, in the next video. I'll also give you a bit more of a sort of textual history and context at the beginning of part two, but today, having explained why it took me so long to get around to this, I want to just dive in with the story of Branwen, the daughter of Llyr. Bendigeid Bran, or Bran the Blessed, son of Clir, was chosen king of the island of Britain, which was called the Island of the Mighty. Probably by the people who lived there, but nonetheless, the Island of the Mighty. And he was crowned in London, which also, as we heard in the previous tale, was where Llebelys, I think, no, or Cleve was crowned in London. I think he set it up as his capital. So a previous king of Britain was crowned there. And one afternoon, Bran, king of the Island of the Mighty, was sat on Harlech Rock, overlooking the Irish Sea. His brother, Manawydan, was with him, as were his two half-brothers, Nisien and Evnisien, and other noblemen besides, a whole company as befits a king of the Island of the Mighty, or the Island of Britain. These two brothers were the sons of a man called Ioroswyf, and their mother was, indeed Bran's mother, Penardin. One of them was a good young man. He would make peace between people and warring armies. This was Nisien. But the other caused enmity even between the two brothers, Bran and Manawydan. And at the best of times, he could be like a snake wedging himself between friends. His name was Evnisien. While they were sitting on the rock, they could see 13 ships coming from the south of Ireland and making towards them. The ships were moving steadily and swiftly with the wind behind them and quickly approaching the shore. "I can see ships over there," said the king, "and they're running towards the shore. Order the men to arm themselves and go and see what they want." Now, a nice little tidbit here is that Harlech today is the site of a later medieval castle on a rock that was, even in medieval times, on the coast. Today the coast is a bit further out, away from the rock, but this rock is likely where Bran and his court were sitting, looking over the sea. "Anyway, tell them to go and see what they want," he said. The men armed themselves and went down towards the shore, and after seeing the ships close at hand, they were all sure they had never seen ships that were more resplendent. Each flew brave and beautiful pennants of silk. And then one of the ships drew ahead of the others, and they could see a shield being raised above the bow. And at the tip of the shield was pointed up in a sign of peace. Then the armed men drew nearer to them so they could each talk to each other. The men on board the ship put out boats and rowed towards the shore and greeted the king. And sitting on the rock high above them, Bran could hear every word that was said. "God bless you," said the king, "and welcome. Whose ships are these? And who is leader among you?" "My lord," they said, "it is Madaloch, the king of Ireland, who is here, and these are his ships." "What does he want?" asked the king. "Does he mean to come ashore? Does he mean to make war?" "He has a request to make of you, my lord," said the Irish. "He won't come ashore if his request is not granted." "What is his request?" asked Bran. "He wants to unite your family with his," they replied. "He has come to ask for Branwen, daughter of Clir, as his wife. And if you agree to this, he wants to unite the Island of the Mighty and Ireland so that they will both be stronger together." "Good," said Bran the Blessed. "Let him come ashore and we will discuss this matter among ourselves." The reply was taken to Madaloch. "I'll go gladly," he said. And Madaloch came ashore and was made welcome. What with his troop of men and Bendigeidvran's company, or Bran the Blessed's company, a large crowd of people gathered in the court at Harlech that night. On the very next day, a council was held, and the decision was taken that the Branwen should be given as a wife to Mabaloch. They agreed to meet in Aberfraw for her wedding, and they all set out from Harlech. The two companies made for Aberfraw in this way: Mabaloch and his men in their ships, Bran the Blessed and his men overland. When they arrived, they soon sat down to feast, and everyone took their proper place, and this is how they sat. Bendigeid Bran, Bran the Blessed, King of the Island of the Mighty and the British, sat with his brother Manawydan, son of Llyr, on one side of him, and Maddaluch, King of the Irish, on his other. And next to Maddaluch sat Branwen, his bride-to-be. And they were not in a house, but rather in a great tent, for there was not room in any house for the giant Bran the Blessed. The feast began, and after eating, they soon started to talk. And when everyone realized that they would do better to go to sleep than to continue feasting, they all went off to sleep. And that night, Maddaluch slept with Branwen. Oh, oh. The following day, all the company of the court got up, and the steward and his officers began to talk of places where they could store the horses and feed the servants and this kind of thing. And they were put out into various places across the country. One day, Evnissian, who apparently hadn't followed the court or the company, the quarrelsome brother, who we've been previously introduced to, came to the stable housing the King of Ireland's horses. "Whose horses are these?" he asked. "These are the horses of Maddaluch, King of Ireland," was the reply.
"And what are they doing here?"
"They're here because Maddaluch, King of Ireland, is here, and he has married your sister. And these are his horses."
"So that's what they've done with such a fine girl as my sister." "She is my sister," said Evnissian. "Well, they couldn't have insulted me more. They've given her away without my consent," he muttered.
And then Evnissian did something terrible. He made for the horses and cut off their lips to the teeth. And he cut their ears flush with their heads and their tails down to the cruppers. And where he could get hold of their eyelids, he cut them to the bone. He maimed the horses in this way so that not one of them was of any use to the King of Ireland. Now, Maddaluch came to hear how his horses had been maimed and made useless. "Indeed, my lord," said one of the servants, "they have disgraced you, and that's exactly what they meant to do." "God knows," said Maddaluch, "it seems strange to me that they mean to disgrace me after having given me such a fine girl as Branwen for a wife, such a noble woman, and one so dear to everyone." "My lord," said another, "later you can find out for yourself whether they meant to disgrace you, but now we have no choice but to make for our ships and back to Ireland." So then Maddaluch made his way to his ships. Now, Bendigeid Bran, Bran the Blessed, heard that Maddaluch was leaving the court without asking permission to do so. He sent messengers to him to ask the reason. These men caught up with the King of Ireland and asked him what he intended to do and why he was leaving. "With God as my witness," said Maddaluch, "I would never have come here if I had known what was going to happen. I have been deeply insulted. No one ever made a worse journey than this. What has happened to me here is beyond my understanding." "Why is that?" asked the servants. "First," he said, "Branwen, the sister of the King of the Island of the Mighty, is given to me, and then I am insulted. What is so strange is that this damage wasn't done before such a fine girl was given to me." "God knows, my lord," they said, "it was not our king's wish, nor the wish of any man in his council, that you should be disgraced in this way. And even though it is a great insult to you, it is even more of a disgrace to Bran himself."
"I agree with that," said Maddaluch, "but even so, that does not undo my disgrace."
The messengers returned his reply to Bran and repeated Maddaluch's words, word for word. "Indeed," said the king, "it will do us no good if he leaves here feeling hostile. We won't allow him to go in this way." "No, my lord," they said. "Send messengers after him again." "I will," he said. Manawydan, son of Llyr, and Hefeddyd the Tall, and Enig the Valiant, Shield, get up and gallop after him. Tell him he shall have a sound horse for every one that was maimed. And above that, to compensate him for the insult to his honour, he shall have a silver staff as thick as his little finger and as tall as himself, and a gold plate as wide as his face. And tell Meddalwch what sort of man it is who did this disgrace to him. Evnissian is a weasel of a man. And tell him it was against my will. I did not intend this to happen, said Bran. Tell him the man who did this was my half-brother, and that because of this it isn't easy for me to kill or punish him. And ask Meddalwch to meet me. Tell him I'll make peace with him in any way he wishes, instructed the giant. Away went the messengers after Meddalwch, and they gave him this message in a spirit of friendship, and the king of Ireland listened. Men, he said, let's take counsel. They talked amongst themselves, and this is what they decided. If they refuse the offer, they might very well end up not with more compensation, but with more disgrace. So Meddalwch decided to accept the offer, and he and his company returned peacefully to the court. Tents were pitched for them to sleep in accordance with the proper plan of a hall, and they went to eat, and to feast, and to discuss. They all took their places there as they had done at the very beginning of the wedding feast. Then Meddalwch and Bendigeid Bran began to talk, and Bran found Meddalwch's conversation lifeless and sad. Before this, his conversation had always delighted him. And he supposed that Meddalwch was dispirited because he thought his compensation was insufficient. I tell you, said Bendigeid Bran, you're not such a good talker tonight as you were before. Why would you say that? Bran, what are you doing? And if this is because you think your compensation's not enough, I'll give you as much as you think right. And tomorrow your horses will be paid to you, said Bran. My lord, said Meddalwch, may God bless you. And I'll increase your compensation in this way too, said Bran. I'll give you a great cauldron. And the wonder of the cauldron is that if one of your men should be killed today, throw him into the cauldron, and by tomorrow he'll be as good as he ever was, except that he won't be able to speak. This is a very important cauldron, bringing people back from the dead. Meddalwch thanked him for this, and no longer felt so heavy-hearted. The following day, Meddalwch was paid in full in horses. That is to say, every trained horse in the court was handed over to the King of Ireland. And then the king was taken to another part of the country, where more horses were given to him there until payment had been made in full. The king was finally satisfied. And for the second night, Bran the Blessed and Meddalwch sat down together. My lord, said Meddalwch, where did you get the cauldron that you've promised me? Tell me more. Well, actually, said Bran, it was given to me by a man who travelled in your country. As far as I know, he got it over in Ireland. Who was he? Asked Meddalwch. Flassar the Canny Barterer, I seem to recall, said Bran. He came here from Ireland, and his wife came with him. They had escaped from an iron house that was set alight while they were still inside it. Imagine such a thing. Have you ever heard about this, Meddalwch? I have indeed, replied the King of Ireland. I'll tell you all I know. One day, he said, I was hunting in Ireland on a hill above a lake, and it's called the Lake of the Cauldron. And I saw a large man with reddish-yellow hair coming out of the lake with a cauldron on his back. He was an enormous man with a harsh face, and a woman and her children followed in his wake. And if he was big, his wife was twice his size, and they came towards me and greeted me. Yes, I said, how are things with you? This is how things are, my lord, he answered. This woman, in 6 weeks' time, she's going to have a baby, and this baby will be born a fully armed warrior, said the man. I took them to my court to look after them. They stayed with me for a year, and during that year there were no complaints from them, but after that they began to grumble. And by the end of the fourth month, they were making themselves disliked and unwelcome in the country of Ireland. They were doing harm and causing distress and upsetting gentle folk. From then on, my people pressed me to get rid of them and gave me a choice, either my kingdom or Flassar and his family. I put the matter of what could be done with them to my country's council. They would not go willingly, and they could not be forced to go against their will because of their huge strength. They were such massive people. So, because of this, my people decided to build a hall out of iron. And the hall was, when the hall was ready, they summoned every smith in Ireland and every man who had owned a hammer and tongs, and they heaped charcoal as high as the roof of the hall, and then plied Thlassar and his wife and children with whatever food and drink they wanted. When it was plain that they were drunk, my people lit the charcoal stacked outside the hall and began to pump the bellows placed around the house, and there was one man for every two bellows, said the King of Ireland. They blew the bellows until the house was white hot. And then the man and his wife talked together inside the hall. Thlassar waited until the iron was white hot and molten and soft enough, for then the heat was intense, but he could shoulder charge the wall and smash his way out. His wife came out after him, and it was after that, I suppose, said the King of Ireland, that he came over to you here in Wales, my lord. It was after that, said Bran, that he came here and gave me this cauldron. My lord, what kind of welcome did you give them? Asked Madaloch. Well, said Bran, I divided Thlassar's family and settled them in every corner of the country. There are a lot of them, and they increase from year to year. They reinforce whatever place they're in, and they make the best warriors and fashion the best weapons we have ever seen. The two kings went on talking that night for as long as it pleased them, and they enjoyed songs and food. And when they realized they would do better to sleep than to just sit there in long into the night, they went to bed. And when this feast had come to an end, Mabinogion set out for Ireland, taking Branwen with him. They set out from Abermenai in 13 ships and returned to Ireland. Now, back home in Ireland, they were given a great welcome like no one had ever seen. No nobleman or lady in Ireland came to visit Branwen without her offering them a brooch or a ring or a jewel, the kind of thing very seldom given as a gift. As a result, people sang Branwen's praises. Pleasant were her days, and she won many friends. Then Branwen became pregnant, and after 9 months gave birth to a son, and he was named Gwern. Gwern was given over to foster parents in the place which was widely acknowledged to be the very best in all of Ireland for rearing men of high standing. The following year, however, there was an outcry in Ireland about the shabby trick that had been played on Mabinogion's horses and the disgrace that he had suffered in Wales. Efnisien's antics had a long shadow. The king's foster brothers and his relatives began to taunt him openly, and soon the whole country was in uproar, and Mabinogion saw that he would get no peace until his wrongdoing had been properly avenged. The horses and the cauldron simply were not payment enough. The vengeance taken on Branwen was to expel her from Mabinogion's chamber and to force her to cook in the court kitchen. The butcher was ordered to come each day and slap her face with his bloodied hands, and that is how she was punished for the sins of Efnisien. Now, my lord, said his men to Mabinogion, stop any ship or boat or coracle coming and going to Wales. And whoever comes here from Wales, throw them into prison. Keep them here in case Bran the Blessed hears rumours about his sister and how we are treating her. And that is exactly what the king did. Things went on like this for 3 years, until Branwen began to play with a starling that had settled on the edge of her kneading bowl. She taught it to speak and told it what kind of man her brother was. A giant of a man, a blessed man, a proud man, a man of Wales, the king of the Island of the Mighty. And she taught her to carry a letter describing her situation and her punishment and her humiliation. And she tied this letter to the bird's wing and sent it flying towards Wales. The end of part one. So it's an interesting tale. And interestingly, other versions of the tale of Branwen and Bran actually separate out the tale of the cauldron into something else. This is one of the branches of the Mabinogion, and people do pull it apart sometimes when they're telling it. So I've heard the tale of the lake of the cauldron and the giant coming out of the lake and the giant's children causing havoc in an elongated fashion in other texts. And also as a child, people would tell me how Flassar's children ate all the food and were boisterous, and because they were so big, they didn't really know how to get their own strength, so they're knocking over people's houses and all this kind of thing. And that's why Matholwch and the King of Ireland decided to expel them to Wales. So it's interesting how in this version, that's a little compressed kind of mini story in the middle of the story. But there we are. We have Branwen in humiliation, sending a letter to her brother, a giant of a man who might not be too happy when he reads of her situation. Hope that you guys have enjoyed this. Thank you so much for watching. In part two, I'll talk a little bit about the origin of this particular text. I've mentioned the origins of the Mabinogion in a previous episode, but maybe I'll talk a little bit about that. And then at the end of part two, we'll also talk a little bit about the implications of how the story ends for modern England, actually, not so much modern Wales, certainly modern Britain, put it that way. As ever, guys, until next time, do take care. Bye-bye. Thank you.